Hi everyone, Sean Humphreys here. I want to welcome you to the video presentation, Investment Planning, Six Mistakes Investors Make. Well, I've had the very fortunate privilege of working with clients for just over 30 years. And over that time frame, I've seen a lot of different case files in terms of successful discipline initiated by clients over the years in terms of their portfolio and not so successful strategies and approaches used by people. And what I want to do in this presentation is cover off some of the key mistakes that investors make that can get in the way of the kind of performance that they would feel satisfied with and the kind of performance they're shooting for in their portfolio. And if you can understand what these crucial mistakes are and avoid them, you improve the probability or the likelihood that you'll achieve your long-term investment goals significantly. So this presentation was recorded. It was a live recording at one of the lunch and learns that we provide for our clients on a regular basis. Hope you enjoy the presentation. If you go to the show notes for this presentation, you'll find the presentation slides. And if you have any questions about the content in the presentation, don't hesitate to contact our office at 204-977-8022. And of course, you can find additional information at our website at www.seanhumphreys.com.
For those of you who don't know who I am, my name is Sean Humphreys, and it's a real pleasure for both myself and my team to host these luncheons. We've been doing this for the last few months, so those of you who have been here before, bear with me. This is really for the benefit of our guests, but we've been hosting these luncheons with the idea that we want to have a very short sort of half hour to 45 minute presentation that will talk about very specific topics. We in January talked about retirement planning, we've talked about insurance risk management, we've talked about tax planning, and today we're going to talk a little bit about investment planning and talk about some of the common mistakes or issues that people get into when they look at their investments and begin investing. Before we get into the presentation, I just want to, again, for the benefit of our guests, just kind of a very brief first name introduction of my team. And so in the back of the room here in the corner is Phil. If you can wave, Phil. Are you going to do your dance number that you were going to do? Oh, no? Okay. Jen to my immediate left, Milan next to Jen, and Janelle at the back. Okay, so if you have any questions about what our team does or questions, if you have questions of me after the presentation and I'm tied up with a discussion and you've got a bit of a tight timeline, don't hesitate to give the question to any member of the team and we'll be sure to get back to you. Welcome. So we're going to talk a little bit about some of the common mistakes that investors make. And I like this image because I think this really kind of illustrates how many people feel about their investments. Sometimes conflicted, sometimes confused, all kinds of options out there in terms of investment planning. There's lots of advice. I mean, you Google any topic in the investment planning arena and you're going to have all kinds of perspectives, all kinds of advice givers out there trying to disseminate advice and provide you with some information. So it can be very daunting and very confusing. But I think there's some very common principles that we can latch on to. And as we latch on to those principles, there's also some very common mistakes that we sometimes unconsciously fall into when we are investing. And so I want to unpack some of those common mistakes and issues that people are confronted with as they go through and build and manage and try to grow their personal wealth through their investments. Now, this is a bit of an infomercial. Some of you have seen this slide before, but this just talks a little bit about our perspective. It's relevant to investment planning. And when you look at our practice, above the advisor box there, so that's Sean and his team, is the client. And of course, everything needs to flow from what the client objectives are. When you look at investment planning, down below the advisor box that you see in the middle of that illustration are some of the functional areas that can impact investment planning. So investment planning is set aside as a separate box, but the reality is issues around tax planning, estate planning, even issues around retirement income planning all play a role in how you design your portfolio. It's astounding to me when I look at information out there about investment planning is that many providers view investments sort of in isolation. And you should never look at your investment portfolio in isolation of your overall planning objectives. The two have to be intimately connected. So I want to share some fundamental beliefs, and not every advisor is going to be in line with these beliefs, but these are our beliefs as it relates to investment planning, and it has a bit of a filter through wealth planning generally. So believe it or not, wealth creates complexity. And so as you grow your wealth, particularly, there are issues that come up. There's issues around tax planning, sometimes estate planning intersect with your investments. Life events happen, and that creates complexity in terms of your investment planning and your wealth planning as well. So a certain level of complexity comes along with your investment portfolio. Believe it or not, wealth and your investments can be emotionally challenging. I'm not telling you anything new there. And when we go through this presentation, we're going to talk a lot about sort of the psychological kind of emotional components to investment planning. There's no doubt that it can be very emotionally challenging, and we need to have some strategies around how to deal with the emotions of investing. I've talked about this before. When you look at your portfolio, you're always best served looking at your portfolio in the context of your overall plan. We default typically to looking at our investments in isolation, and we should be always looking at our investments in the context of our overall plan. I'll talk about that in a little more detail in a few minutes. One of the things that we constantly talk about in terms of our role is to guide clients through transitions. There is a quote that I often talk about. It's a clinical psychologist that I know. And Moira goes, you know, when life changes, money changes, and when money changes, life changes. You can't really pull the two apart. And so we're constantly going through the ebbs and flows of life, and as we go through transitions, whether it's retirement or death of a partner or a new career or family come along and you have kids, those are all events that have an impact on your finances and on your portfolio often. And of course, all of us are unique. Okay, there's no such thing as a boilerplate, templated investment strategy. It needs to be very specific to your circumstances. So before we get into the presentation, I want to go through and just give a little bit of an investment 101 that we need to cover off. And you may want to write this down by way of review. So we have three major asset classes we're going to talk about. Actually, two of them we're going to talk about in a little more detail today, and one in specifics in a lot of detail. So the first asset class is cash. So when we're talking about cash, what kind of investments are we talking about? Just throw out ideas. T-bills. So government T-bills. Checking your savings accounts. Absolutely. Art. Sometimes. Bonds. So short-term bonds or T-bills. Term deposits. Guaranteed investment certificates. Okay, so bonds. When I talk about bonds, I'm not talking about Canada savings bonds. So what are some examples of bonds? We got corporate debentures. Those are corporate bonds. So most publicly traded companies will have bonds at the issue in the public markets. I can buy federal government bonds. I can buy provincial bonds. I can buy municipal bonds. Okay, and we'll talk about the difference between buying a bond and buying a GIC in a minute. And then stocks. For the purpose of our discussion today, we're going to talk about stocks and the broad markets. And so I think you know generally what stocks are, but for the discussion today, stocks are ownership in a company, in a business. I'm not going to spend a lot of time unpacking that today. We're going to talk about the broad themes around the stock market and how it behaves and why we may want to have stocks in our portfolio. Now, the one thing about cash investments is cash doesn't trade. What do we mean by that? What I mean by that is when you walk into your bank and you try to pull money out of your bank account or checking account, does the teller or client service representative say to you, well, your account was worth $9,000 yesterday, but it's worth $9,500 today? Did they say that to you? No, of course not. Your term deposit was worth $10,000 yesterday. It's now worth $8,000 today because of the markets. You don't worry about that because these securities are not traded. There's no public secondary market for term deposits, cash accounts, GICs, right? So what you put in, you get back out, you get a certain interest rate. With bonds and stocks, there's something called a secondary market. And a good example would be buying a bond. If I bought a Government of Canada bond, a federal bond going out 20 years, and I'm getting 3% interest on that bond, I know that 20 years from now, the $10,000 I invest, I get back in 20 years. And I get that interest payment twice a year, right, through that 20-year period. It's fully guaranteed. But between now and 20 years, what happens with that bond if I wanted to cash out that bond before it matures? The only thing you need to really think about with a bond is, what's its interest rate, when does it mature, and how does its interest rate compare to prevailing current interest rates? So if there's a market for buying and selling bonds after you buy one, whether or not you sell it or not, there's a market. Okay? So if your bond pays 4% and interest rates go up to 5%, does anyone want to buy your bond? Why? Yeah, they can get a better interest rate than what your bond's currently paying. If you had to sell your bond, what would you have to do to unload that bond? You'd have to sell it at a loss, right? Right? So bonds can trade up and down. Now, stocks trade up and down as well. I'm not going to talk about the main reasons for that, but the big thing to take home here is bonds and stocks trade in the secondary market. Okay, so they'll go up and down in value based on a whole bunch of different criteria. Now, if bonds and stocks fluctuate, why would I ever buy one? Wouldn't it be just much more comfortable just buying a GIC, a term deposit, or sitting in cash? Well, I think that most of us, if I scan the room, I'd say probably most of you would go, absolutely. I would much rather have my money in term deposits and high yield savings accounts, and I'd be happy with that. I'd be very zen-like in terms of my portfolio, right? So why don't we? Well, one reason is return. I'm going to show you a chart in a second. Return's sometimes an issue, right? Back in I think I've talked about this in the retirement seminar, my dad retired in 1982 from SaskTel. What were five-year GICs paying back in 1982, 1981? About 18%. Mortgages were about 21%. Imagine locking into a five-year or even a 10-year bond at 18%, right? So return's a bit of an issue for many investors. Maybe the GIC that pays 2% or 1.75 or 2.25 or whatever it is isn't giving you enough return, so you won't reach your goals. You'll go through that capital. So you won't lose capital because the market's going down. You'll lose capital because you're killing the goose that lays the golden egg too quickly because it's not generating enough return for you. Okay? How about tax? There are some tax advantages attached to both bond portfolios as well as stock portfolios. Okay, I won't go into that in detail today. We talked about that in the tax planning seminar. So make sure you go back to our website and you can Google the different videos, and we have a session on how various investments are taxed. And maybe we're going to diversify our portfolio a little bit. And so you might add other asset classes to diversify. And we'll talk about why that might be important. This is an extraordinary chart. This gets back to my discussion about my dad when he retired. So it's hard to make this out, but we got 1982 here. And in 1982, if I wanted to generate $25,000 of income just by buying GICs, five-year GICs, how much money did I have to have in my portfolio? When you're going to generate $25,000 a year of income, I'm going to put it all in five-year GICs. Yeah, pretty close to that. $155,000 of capital. In 2014, if I wanted to generate $25,000, how much capital do I need? $1.2 million. So the reason that we look at diversifying is we've gone through a 30, 40-year period declining interest rates. And I won't talk about it today, but don't expect interest rates to go up anytime soon. So we're collectively forced to look at other strategies to build our portfolios that hopefully will give us some competitive returns over time. Okay? That's why we do this, because of this situation we have right now. Interest rates are at a historic low ebb, and it takes way more capital to generate income at equivalent rates back to 1982. Okay, so to set this up for you, this isn't going to apply to any of you, because you deal with financial planners. So this is just for that great unwashed mass out there. They're going through some problems, potentially. So how is the general investor doing out there? And for the purpose of our discussion, I'm focused more on the equity stock. For the purposes of our discussion today, just think of two words. And some of you went through some of the workshops I did years ago, and I used two words to define investments. One was loanership. So when you buy a loanership investment, that's loaning money, that's a bond or a GIC or a savings account. And the other category is ownership, stocks, stock mutual funds, the stock market. Okay, so what we're talking about today is the stock market. Why would we be talking about the market? Because a lot of investors have money in the stock market directly or indirectly. They have it in the market because they feel they need some exposure to the market to get the returns that they want. They may not necessarily be there because they want to be there. It's an intellectual decision. They realize that maybe we need to have exposure to the stock market to get the returns that they want over the mid to long term. But with that decision come some problems. And you need to really keep this in mind throughout the presentation. This is only relevant if you need to have some exposure to stocks in your portfolio. If you can get away with just buying government bonds or even term deposits or GICs, this discussion is not as relevant. But if you need exposure to stocks or growth investments, this is where the presentation is going. Okay, so what's the average investor doing here? So this is a chart that J.P. Morgan in the States had put together, and it's a very interesting chart. What it does is it takes a look at capital inflows and outflows, and it compares retail investors, you and I. Of course, we don't behave like these investors, though. We're sort of more disciplined. And then institutional investors. And this is cumulative. This isn't year to year. This is a cumulative total of inflows of capital to equity mutual funds or equity investments over this time period between 2007 to 2014. And you see a dramatic difference. I mean, retail investors are doing exactly the opposite of what institutional investors are doing. Now, if the institutional investors were brain dead or didn't know what they were doing or maybe taking unnecessary risks, you could view that maybe what the retail investors are doing here is prudent. It's appropriate. So how did the retail investors do? What did this do in terms of performance? They were doing exactly the opposite of what pension managers, fund managers, foundation managers, managing assets on behalf of other people, their financial intermediaries, and they're doing exactly the opposite. So that's the average client buying an investment and not adding to it but pulling out of it through this whole time period. I'll come back to how they did in a second. This is another way of looking at it. This is a very busy chart. It's hard to make it out here, but you see these spikes here? Very dramatic spikes. Again, these are retail investors. So what's happening is during times when the market is going up, they're pulling money out. When times when the market's going down, right, they're pulling money out. When the times markets are going up, what's your retail investor doing? They're net buyers. Okay? So they're never behaving in a contrarian fashion. Now that might be appropriate sometimes, but what they're doing is they're doing exactly the opposite of what the markets, you know, what institutional investors are doing. When the markets are going down, are they adding? Not typically. Right? They're usually selling. Okay, so this chart goes through. This is very instructive. Okay, so this is U.S. data, but I don't think Canadian investors are any different. So this tracks each of the major asset classes. So we've got real estate, just over 10% a year. This is between 1994 and what's that, 2013. We have oil. Now that's cratered a little bit lately, but we've got various market investments. We've got European index. We've got the U.S. index at, close to 10% a year over that time period. European index, gold, and then bonds. And we trickle along here. Who's that? Average investor. So the average investor didn't do a lot better than inflation over that time period. Okay, so again, we can come to a lot of different conclusions around this, but what we know for sure is that as institutional money managers were buying, retail investors were selling. And the long-term impact of that behavior was, over that period of time, they underperformed the major investment classes by a wide, wide margin. And in fact, the average investor didn't get any more than basically the inflation rate on their portfolio. Okay? This is another way of looking at it. The left-hand bar represents the average return. I just took the average return of stock mutual funds over an extended period of time. And if you look at the bar on the right, that's the average investor's return. So if you take a look at that, the performance on this index was 8.2% net to the fund manager who was managing the portfolio. These are equity funds. And the average return for retail investors was 3.5%. Now that's a huge, huge delta. Like if you take that over a 10-year, 15, 20-year period, that's meaningful wealth erosion or opportunity cost for the average investor. Okay? So again, what's happening here? Why are we seeing such underperformance? Peter Lynch, who managed a fund called the Magellan Fund, very famous portfolio manager, was an international balanced fund, and he had top performance for 30 years. And the majority of unit holders that held his investment fund lost money. So how does that happen? How do you have a portfolio manager that does amazingly well over time, makes lots of money for the portfolio, but the average unit holder lost money? Well, all we have to do is go back to this chart. Because the average unit holder was selling when the market, right, had opportunity embedded in it. Right? And they were buying when the market was overvalued. Okay, so I set it up for you. None of us share the characteristics of the average investor. We're all unique, and I do know, I mean, for the most of you that are in this room where I know you personally, you've acted with discipline, right? You have done that. And some of you have done it without a lot of counsel or coaching from me, and some of you have done it with a tremendous amount of coaching and counseling from me, right? So sometimes my meetings are less about the facts of the market, so more about just sort of, again, I call it behavioral coaching, just trying to give people a perspective on the markets a little bit. Okay, so what's leading to the underperformance? Let's talk about some of the behaviors, issues that come up for investors. Okay, so I'm going to talk first of all about what we refer to as unconscious influences. And I'm going to give you some images. You'll know right away what I'm talking about here. You know, I have social media. I'm using social media as a bit of a representation for the fact that we're getting information from all kinds of sources today. We're just, you know, engulfed in just an avalanche of information. And so whether it's social media, whether it is, you know, different kinds of technology, TV, they're all beaming information in our direction. And a really good way of looking at this is through this particular slide, which it takes all the potential sources that you can think of. You have advertising. Neighbors. This is a great one. I often get you know, neighbors and friends. And I've, over the years, clients have made some comments to me. And I'll ask the question, that's great that they're having amazing performance on their portfolio. They seem to be just hitting the lights out in terms of what, you know, other people are doing, but do you know how they did it? Do you have any information that kind of corroborates the fact that their start of the portfolio and the end of the portfolio, they actually made money? What's your process? They have a delineated process for managing their portfolio. I mean, there's usually a dearth of information or data. It's sort of cocktail chatter about things, right? That's how it often goes. But the reality is we're influenced by this stuff. So we are immersed in all this information, people we respect, influences, and so I can't help but be a background kind of influencer when we're making investment decisions. And we'll see that in a minute when we look at the different psychological aspects of investing and what we do unconsciously to get in the way of being successful in this area. A great example are these guys. I'll use CNN as just a metaphor for what goes on with news media outlets. So I watch CNN like, you know, many of you do. But it's amazing. They can take a news story that is Sean walked across the street to get in his car to drive home. That sounds like a fairly benign kind of news event. And CNN could take that and just blow it up and make it the most sensational event on the planet. So CNN knows that they have to sell circulation. They need eyeballs. And every single news outlet that you're watching, whether it's the national news or CNN or Fox News or Business News, BNN, that's their reality. Doesn't mean they're lying to you, but they do have a reality, which means they're going to tilt information and give you part of the truth. But the truth they're going to emphasize is the truth that gets your attention. And what gets your attention? Bad news. Good news never gets your attention. They're always going to talk about the bad news. Now, this profoundly impacts us as investors. We're immersed in this stuff. Well, maybe some of you aren't. Maybe you're not tapped into technology. But more and more, we're tapped into technology. We're immersed in this stuff. And what it does is it has these subtle background influences on our behavior. So I'm going to talk about reduced cognition. So that's one impact. We'll talk about that in a second. Anxiety. And it creates a reactive response. So what I'm talking about. So we've talked about this a little bit before, I think, in past sessions or workshops. So we have something called the amygdala in our brain, two little almond-shaped organs in our brain. And what the amygdala does is attunes us to danger. So we're constantly kind of in this mode of, is there danger around us? And so, you know, it's the old sort of running from the tiger or fighting the tiger. Are we going to get eaten? Are we going to fight our way out? And so we're wired to be attuned to negative news and danger. That's why it gets our attention. The problem is we're immersed in all this negative news. So you may not agree with that, but, you know, many people are walking around in low-grade anxiety. And because you're in low-grade anxiety, their ability to tap into their prefrontal cortex, their thinking part of their brain, is sometimes compromised a little bit. So when you're watching the news, and there's all this negative stuff going on, and then you're talking about capital markets, and you're by yourself, you're with your partner, and you're having some potato chips, and you're already feeling guilty, and then you're watching it, and you're going, my goodness, like the sky is falling in. We better talk to Sean tomorrow. I'm really concerned about what's going on. Right? And so it drives this sort of behavior, and the behavior often becomes very reactive. So with this anxiety, this low grade. So the only thing I'm going to say here is you need to make sure that you're taking active steps just to assess. Like, if you are in low grade anxiety, maybe sometimes the best thing to do is not to be really overly worried about your portfolio. Maybe go for a walk, right? Take some deep breaths, right? I'm not trying to dismiss the issue, but sometimes that's what it should be. Part of investment planning should be meditation 101. Like, what can I do to sort of get some of this anxiety cathartically out of my system? So it's hard to make out this chart, I apologize, okay? But let me speak to this chart. Fear recedes with time. And I like this chart because the basic idea is this. Geopolitical events are happening all the time. Every single day, you're going to wake up and there's going to be some negative news. Terror strikes, economic news, calamity. The geopolitical events get a lot of press, and they do have a short-term impact on capital markets. But what investors do is they use a geopolitical event as a proxy for making investment decisions. And what this chart is showing you is there's no correlation between the geopolitical events going on around us and what you should be doing with your portfolio. And yet, the most common questions I get are how will the U.S. election, and it's not a bad question, by the way. I'm not saying you shouldn't have the question. How is the U.S. election going to affect my portfolio, the U.S. dollar, currencies, you know, the markets? What happens with, ISIS, if they continue making incursions into Syria, maybe create more of a bloodbath? You name it, it's going to come up. But keep this in mind again, there's no correlation between those events. Markets will go through sometimes short-term volatility, but what this chart demonstrates is that, with rare exception, and there's only one major exception, which was the Israeli-Arab War of 1973. That was an exception. But most of the issues are non-issues after a very short period of time. So you need to keep that in mind, because again, maybe none of you succumb to this, but it's a very, very common point of conversation for me is, you know, how are these geopolitical issues going to impact my portfolio? And what the data shows is it's more often than not an irrelevant discussion as it relates to your portfolio going out the next 12, 24, 36 months. Now, if you need access to your portfolio in the next 12 months and there's a geopolitical event that creates a bit of a downdraft in the market over the next 12 months, well, then there's a bit of an issue. But there's ways of dealing with that kind of risk. But it's not going to be a long-term issue you need to be concerned about, right? So try not to make the connection between those news events and your portfolio. Usually it's not a connection point that makes any sense, at least in the data. Okay, we're going to talk about general lack of understanding. And I talk about a few basic concepts. Some of these you've heard from me before. I think that they're really good points of reference when we're looking at our portfolio. So the first one I'm going to talk about, let me set it up for you. There's lots of news magazines, online reports, lots of pundits will be able to tell you. Some of these same, you know, CNN will bring in pundits every day, talk about what the future is going to look like. I'm just astounded at how many people have crystal balls that they can look in the future and tell us, you know, what's going to happen. And you go back and you back test all kinds of prognosticators, they're, majority of the time, they're wrong. And yet we consume the information. So there's a basic understanding by many investors that we can somehow time the market. You've heard this conversation before, some of you, that if we read the economic tea leaves, if we really do our research, we can somehow time the market. You know, miss the bad days and get the good days, and it's, again, nirvana. It's bliss from an investment standpoint. So is that really possible? Well, maybe some investors have reasonably good predictive ability, but they're really playing against the odds here. And so what this chart is, it's a great illustration of the fallacy of trying to play around with those numbers. So this looks at a time period, you know, basically last 10-year period. I think that the 10-year period ended in 2013 in this chart. And we have roughly 2,500 trading days. If you look at the time period in this chart, along the lower axis here, we've got about 2,500 trading days, probably a little more than that. And the first bar represents the returns in the portfolio. This is the TSX, so this is the Canadian market. Just under 7% a year compounded, dividends reinvested. This is a very hard period. I mean, you go into this time horizon here and you've got, you know, the financial crisis of 2008, just that one event. You know, that kicked the pants out of performance for sure. But, you know, close to a 7% return. Now, what's interesting in this chart is if you took the top 10 days out of the 2,500 days, which represents about 0.4% of the total days, right, that the market was open, if you took those 10 days out of this calculation, can you see what the return was? It's 0.3%. So it went from 6.6 or almost 7% return on the market to 0.3%. So what happened when we took out the top 20 days? We're in negative territory. Now this is a very important principle, and it's one of the reasons why many investors don't do well with their portfolios. It's very few number of days that drive most of the performance in your portfolio. It's very concentrated. And this is a real dilemma for us, right? If we're building a portfolio and I sit down with a client and they need 4.5% returns on their account and GICs are paying 2.5%, we're going to need some diversification in the portfolio and we're probably going to need some exposure to the stock market. That's just the reality. If that goal is important for the client, if they're not getting enough return in the GICs. And the minute we go down this path, this takes amazing amount of discipline to take advantage of these market forces. If only 10 days drive basically all the portfolio, how difficult is that? That is very, very difficult for all of us in this room. You could go through long stretches of time with very little return. And at the point of maximum pessimism, just about when you're about to bail, right, the market rallies. Hopefully you stayed long enough in to capture that rally. Okay, it's a very simple chart, but if you latch onto anything here, it's just understanding the reality of equity investing. And you know, we do it because we try to manage out risk as much as possible, but this very simple concept is something to keep in mind. Very concentrated numbers of days drive most of your performance. Okay, so we're going to continue on. So that's one issue. So we're going to talk about bulls and bears as part of this discussion. Before we do that, I got a couple of quotes. I thought this English proverb was just awesome. I think I got this from Phil. Phil's very literary, very Shakespearean-like. So I should have Phil read this. He has a very, very nice English accent. He that cannot abide a bad market deserves not a good one. That was John Ray. He lived between 1627 and 1705. It was an English proverb. Here's an interesting quote from Enivar Sowali from the book The Lights of Canopus. The nightingale which cannot bear the thorn, it is best that it should never speak of the rose. Okay, so what are these quotes getting at? You can't get bull market returns without experiencing a little bit of sharp pain once in a while. It's a fallacy to believe that we can get good returns from bull markets without going through temporary pain of the bad market. It's not statistically something you can do. But I'll tell you, just Google, you know, whether you can do it or not. And there's lots of people willing to sell information that says exactly opposite to what I'm telling you right now. Okay, so how do you define a bull? Anyone want to define? I'm not going to, actually, let's not talk about bull markets. We're not concerned about bull markets. That's a good market. How do you define a bear market? Anyone want to give me a definition? It's not a very sophisticated definition. So what happens when a bear market hits? So market's going down. And for many, I mean, there's not real consensus around this, but the majority opinion is a bear market, which is kind of a protracted downward market spiral, will be at least 20% down and will have a duration of at least 2 months. So that's kind of technically, once you get into a two-month period and the market's, stock market's down 20%, in the major broad indexes. So it can't just be, you know, the Canadian market's down 20% for more than 2 months. It's the S&P, the broad-based U.S. market, the IFA, the international European market, so for a two-month period. Now, sometimes we hear the word correction. A correction is not the same as a bear market. So a correction could be, you know, the market goes down, but it's for a relatively short period of time. Those geopolitical events I talk about often lead to a short-term correction, but then you see the market retracing its path pretty quickly. Okay, so what builds a lot of fear into people's minds, though, is this notion of bear markets. But yet, look at here, the bull and the bear are shaking hands. How much sense does that make, right? If you look at a lot of the metaphors, the imagery around bull and bears, those of you who looked at it, what does it usually show? Carnage, turmoil, you know, the bull is goring the bear. I mean, it's just unbelievable. And we have an advisor in our office. He actually has this beautiful painting of that illustration. I'm going, you really have that in your office? That's what clients see when they come in talking about your portfolio? So I much rather like this image, which is they're shaking hands. You imagine the bull and the bear are shaking hands. Does that make any sense whatsoever? As we get through the presentation, understand why. Because you need bear markets to get bull markets. They don't happen independently. They are part of one process that drives long-term growth in a portfolio. So I'll show you a very interesting illustration. So we got an extended period of time here. And so I think this is going. Yeah, 1980 through to 2014, I think. Yeah. So I'm going to show you, and this is the S&P 500, so the broad-based stock market in the U.S., which is a good representative sampling of this. So I'm going to show you all the positive years over that time period. Oh, there are none. Okay, there you go. Okay, so lots of positive years. I mean, it wasn't all carnage. It wasn't all negative. It wasn't all the luck of the draw. The stock market's nothing but a casino. It's nothing but gambling. No, there's a lot of positive years there. Let's look at the something else here. These are the negative years. Okay, and what you can see is there's far more positive years than negative years. So there's one particular bad negative year, and that was 2008. But you know, if you go back, you know, over time, more positive years and negative years. Now, what's really interesting is this chart. So what I'm showing you here is the intra-year negative, the worst negative return intra-year within that calendar year every single year. So are you seeing a pattern for the positive years? You weren't getting intra-year declines just on the negative years. You were getting some very significant intra-year declines for the positive years. And this is also one of the reasons when clients ask me about returns, I always say, well, let's look at calendar returns. This is kind of book in the year. Because one of the reasons for that is you can see like wide swings within a one-year period. Within that year, it's extremely variable. So the other principle that you need to have is just this understanding that that short-term volatility is going to be there even in the years that we experience a good return. You're going to go through a period where that intra-year can be extremely volatile. It just comes with the territory. And I know when I've had meetings with clients the last 6 months, I mean, that's been part of the territory. I mean, the first 2 months of the year were a little bit choppy, right? And we're beginning to see a little bit of recovery, but that's just kind of on the stock part of a portfolio. That's sort of how it works. So here's some wisdom that hopefully we can gain from that slide. So 28 out of 35 years were positive. It's the majority, of course. The average intra-year decline was approximately 14%. So in spite of all those great years over the years, within that positive year was a minus 14. Now again, not only is it difficult to do well in equity or growth investments because of those 10 days, remember that short little sort of amount of days that drive return, even in those years where you do get some decent returns, it can be tough because of the short-term volatility. The average return over the entire 35 years was about 9%. And this is a really interesting quote. This is from Benjamin Graham, who is sort of the godfather of investing principles. We talk about having a structure and a process. His theories were seminal in how portfolio managers manage money. And he said, in the short term, the stock market is a voting machine, but in the long term, it's a weighing machine. What is he getting at there? Anyone brave enough to take a stab on what is it? What does he mean? It's a voting machine in the short term and a weighing machine in the long term. So when you talk about voting, we often think of things like popularity, right? Like it's a popularity contest. And you can see that in the markets. Do you have some examples in your own experience about popularity contests where stocks didn't have any intrinsic real value? They didn't really weigh anything. They had no real value, but they were really popular. Nortel, anyone know about Nortel? Research in motion. The dot-com boom. Gold, does gold ever go through periods of absolute euphoria? Right? It's a voting machine. It's a popularity contest. So this is another principle you need to understand when you invest money. The market in the short term is not giving you necessarily the true intrinsic value or weight of the securities in your portfolio. It's a popularity contest. And your institutional money manager, your professional money managers are investing money in aggregate with all these other investors. And not all investors are making decisions based on the true weight and value of the securities. There's many investors making decisions based on popularity, fads. That's the extent of their investment process. So you can't rely on those short-term popularity votes to drive long-term intrinsic value. But over the long term, the market has a great ability to punt out, the imposters, to punt out the frauds. So over time, you get true intrinsic weight or value in your portfolio. The next principle we need to keep in mind, you want to write this down, time matters. And so when you talk about time matters, this is kind of an interesting chart. And this chart looks at the rolling averages, the one-year returns of a portfolio mix. It was 40% bonds and 60% stocks. And you can see when you look at this chart, can you see that number? So the negative return numbers were what? About 20 or 23? And so if you look at the worst return over that time period was what? Minus 20. And the best return, 1 year returns, was?
27.
Okay, so you can see huge variability. And this over this rolling 12-month period over a number of years, fair amount of volatility, right? So that'd be pretty hard to stomach, but that's 1 year returns, right? Every 1 year return over that time period on this balanced portfolio. So now we're looking at 36 months. So going from a 12-month period to a 36-month period, and you can see in that same portfolio that, you know, the worst 36-month period, there still was a negative return, but it's a lot less negative, right? But you did go through some years there where the 36-month return was still in negative territory. And then over 60 months, you've got a portfolio that never actually experienced a losing 60-month period. So take every 60-month period, there was always a positive experience. Now, some of the positive experiences weren't great, but it's one of the reasons when we talk to, you know, clients about time horizon, this is why it's so critical. On a growth portfolio, if we have enough time, we can ride through some of that short-term volatility. It's not going to happen right away, but usually within a 5-year or 60-month period, you're going to get through the worst of it. Okay? So just time is really important to keep in mind. So when you talk about bear markets, they're essential. They're an organic element. The bear and the bull have to shake hands for them to happen. You can't get one without the other. There are temporary interruptions. So typically a bear market is temporary. It's not long-term. And the reason that the returns in your equity investments are better than your bond investment returns, okay? So it's that trade-off. You can't get one without the other. Now, what this chart is, it's a very busy chart, but what it's telling you is the different return numbers from highest to lowest, typically, of all the major investment categories that you can invest in. This is called the investment quilt. It just tells you it's quite variable in terms of the range of returns in all these different categories. So how can you actually predict it? You can't. And so one of the questions I get from clients is, Sean, why don't we have more of that stuff in our portfolio and less of that stuff? You know, that didn't do very well last year. I want more of that. Let's punt this stuff out of the portfolio. And I'm going, well, if we had a crystal ball, we would do that, right? But there's a variability, there's a short-term randomness to returns, and so you'd build a diversified portfolio. And one of the things that we talk about with clients is a principle is that, you know, 85 to 90% of your returns on any portfolio are driven by your investment mix. How much you have in cash, how much you have in real estate, how much you have in bonds, how much you have in stocks. That actually, things like security selection and market timing, all this stuff, this is most of what the news talks about, right? Market timing, security selection, you know, all these different areas account for a very small percentage of your total return over time. Most of your returns, if you look back, will be based on how much you had in bonds, how much you had in stocks, how much you had in real estate and cash. That's what's going to drive your return. I'm not saying those other categories aren't important, but these are really the determiners of return. So when we sit down and I talk about asset mix, that's what we talk about that. You know, the portfolio manager you choose, the investments you choose are important, but they're not the most important decision. It's going to be your asset mix return or your asset mix that will drive that. And of course, behavior coaching comes along with that. I'm going to go through this first. I have to talk about this chart. This chart is very interesting in that it unpacks the long-term returns pre-inflation, post-inflation on portfolios. It's hard to see this. But the bottom line on this chart is if you go to the after-inflation returns, right, between these different portfolio mixes, right, from a very conservative portfolio to a 100% stock portfolio, when you look at pre-inflation, the stock portfolio has way more negative performance than the cash portfolio, obviously. When you factor in inflation and look at after-inflation returns, is there a huge difference between cash, bonds, and stocks? There really isn't. I won't spend a lot of time on this chart, but it's really important that as investors we think about not our gross returns, but our net after inflation returns when we look at portfolios. All right, think about those periods of time when inflation was extremely high, right? And you think that you're doing okay on your portfolio, but when in fact your fixed income assets or other assets are really eroding their purchasing power. They're actually negative return territory. Okay, so this will be part of the follow-up material when you put together the video. You can see that in more detail. The other point that I want to make is the absolute critical importance of rebalancing portfolios. And most of you know this. When we talk about your portfolio mix, we're constantly talking about, do we rebalance, do we fine-tune? Nothing's static in life. Your goals change, your personal objectives change, your family circumstances change, and market environments change. So all those things have an impact on how you structure your portfolio, and so part of what you need to be doing over time is rebalancing. Again, we fall in love with our good performers. And so rebalancing seems a little bit counterintuitive. You mean you want to take money from the best performing part of my portfolio and add to the worst performing? That doesn't seem to make sense. But if you go back to my original slides, it absolutely makes sense to be contrarian and to constantly rebalance your portfolio to take advantage of those swings. Okay, so this is another behavior that doesn't happen, and this is a lack of a plan. So again, for most of you that are clients, we've got plans in place. We didn't start talking about the portfolio and its structure and our return objectives until we looked at your plan. Because it's your wealth plan, your financial plan, that drives the kind of returns that you need to get from your portfolio. You should always start with a plan first. You can't build a portfolio in a vacuum. So if we're doing that, and the plan says we need to get 5% to fund our objectives financially, then the portfolio you're going to design has to give us hopefully a high probability or the greatest probability possible to try to hit that goal return. Right? So it's very important that when you think of your portfolio, always think about it in the context of your plan. Am I getting sufficient returns to hit those goals? I care, but I'll be dramatic here. I don't really care what the S&P does today. I don't really care what the TSX does. I don't care what gold does or where the Canadian dollar went. Okay, I do care about those things, but in the context of your plan, the only thing that matters is the return that you need to get. If you need to get 4.5% or 5%, then that's the return we have to worry about. And if you're not tracking in that return range, why not? What fine-tuning do we need to make to get you there? Is there a concern? Right? That's the discussion. How are we tracking against my plan? Not how am I tracking against the broad market. The broad market has a bit of an impact on the design of your portfolio, but when you invest money, you better have a plan, because that's going to drive all the decisions around the structure of your portfolio. Okay, so we're running out of time a little bit, so I'm not going to spend a huge amount of time on cognitive biases, and yet it's a really important area. So let me go through this. So this is mistake number 4, succumbing to cognitive biases. So the first one is crowd following. And I don't think you have to be a rocket scientist to know what I'm talking about here, is at peak market cycles, it only takes 5% of the population in a group or a crowd to influence the other 95%. So what you tend to see is these stages of euphoria in the markets and then absolute depths of depression. And what's happening is a very small number of investors are driving behavior in the capital markets. And we all succumb to this. So we have to show a little bit of humility at times and understand that these forces are working in the background all the time for us. It's very easy for us to be influenced by the crowd, right? And there's a lot of psychological reasons, a lot of research that would support that. You just need to understand that there is that impact. So as crowds move in a certain direction, you need to take a step back a little bit and go, okay, is this the right move? Just because everyone's doing it doesn't necessarily mean that I should be doing it, right? So there is that bias. Overconfidence. So you can get a little bit overconfident with things, and we see that through different market cycles. So you have a portfolio that's doing really well, or you pick an investment that does very well, and you think a lot of it has to do with, you know, your stock picking ability or your insight or your wisdom. But again, you need to show a little bit of humility there. It's not always because of your insights. And sometimes we get so overconfident on issues that we don't look at things clearly, right? So I think most of my clients have a fair amount of humility. They don't really look at it, as, you know, they're not overconfident about certain issues. Certain issues they might be, but on investments they're not typically. Loss aversion. And so I'll talk about that in a minute. Here's a good example of not wanting to sell our losers or trying to buy, you know, our winners again. I'll give you an example of loss, something that can tie into loss aversion. I'm going to give you a little story here. You tell me whether you'd succumb to this bias. So I'm going to read the story. Pay attention. It's very important. Okay, so you catch a show at the local theater, and tickets are $20 each. When you get there, you realize you've lost a $20 bill. Do you buy a $20 ticket for the show anyway? What do you think the majority of people did? Did they just not go, I'm just going to... Yeah, 88% of the people in this situation would buy the ticket, even though they lost the $20. Now, let's say you paid for the $20 ticket in advance. And when you arrive at the door, you realize your ticket's at home. Would you pay $20 to purchase another? Well, only 40% of the people did. So 88% of the people bought a ticket when they lost the cash, but only 40% of the people bought a ticket when they lost the ticket. But are the two situations different economically? They're exactly the same, right? And yet the behavior was radically different. So when you look at behavioral finance and just behaviors that we initiate, that's just one example. We're blind to certain things that influence our behaviors around not just an area like that, but influence our approach to investing. Family of origin. Family of origin is interesting, and this is where we get into issues of, I grew up in a home where money was tight. We just counted every penny, and you know what? I deserve it. I deserve that holiday. I deserve to do that kind of thing. And it almost kind of bleeds into being a spendthrift. So you'd think that would be the opposite, but often people feel like, I had a hard time. I deserve to do those things, right? And you have the opposite, where someone had lots and came from a situation where, stuff was bought, but there were some negative implications around that. And they end up being very, very tight with their money. They budget, and they have the sense of security around how they organize their situation. Sometimes it's confidence issues. So if you were in a home where money had sort of a power position, or money was something that you gave out as a way of making a difference in the world. All these kinds of things influence our approach at a subconscious level in how we manage money. And I'm not saying that, or another example, business people, the only reason they did well in business is they took advantage of people, right? They're dishonest, that's how they make their money, right? And there's some people that have that belief system, right? So it's not that these beliefs are just floating around. I'm not saying they're right or wrong necessarily. The big thing about your family of origin and your life experience and where you grew up is that it's worth reflecting on. Because if you're not conscious of those things, right, they're unconscious, they can lead to certain decisions, right, around your money and your portfolio that may not be that productive. So you get back to, you're tired, you're watching the news, there's lots of negative events, you're having those potato chips, you're already feeling guilty, right? And all of a sudden, your family of origin issues kind of kick in as well. And you take that constellation and boom, you've got a reactive decision that's not a productive decision for your portfolio. Okay? So I think it's probably worth just reflecting on a bit. Employer industry, we see this all the time with business owners. They're very confident about managing their business, and they typically under-diversify. They have all their assets in their business, right? They feel that's the best place to put their money, and for the most part it is, but they get into this sort of bias around their business, and that can have devastating impacts if the market goes through a downturn, they lose their business. You see people with stock options with large companies. They invest all their money in stock options and different benefits with their employer, and they don't diversify, right? They have sort of this tunnel vision around their industry and the company they work for, and they become too invested. They're not objective enough around the organization that they're with. Superman bias, I don't cover that today, but. And how we weigh gain and loss, I talked about that a little bit already with the story that I talked about. Okay, so we're almost done. Janelle's been really good at, look at this, 1 o'clock. So we just have a few minutes left. Let me just unpack this for you. And this is one of the other issues that come up for people. Now this is probably the most self-serving part of the presentation I'm gonna go through today, but it is true. Coaching is critical. I think that if you look at everything we've talked about so far, in my mind anyway, most success is going to take place in a portfolio over time is likely going to be in the context of a coaching relationship, right? And I think that's the case in a lot of areas of life, like whether it's hiring a coach in terms of sports or hiring a coach in terms of my fitness and wellness program, hiring a coach financially, having an accountant give, do my returns and give me advice on that. There's this coaching relationship that breeds accountability, right? It breeds a certain, okay, awareness, top of mind that certain issues need to be attended to. And so what does a coach do? Okay, they get to know you. They assess your current situation, right? That's part of what this whole discussion has been about, right? Assessing your current situation, your plan. Looking at gaps and opportunities, developing an action plan. And I think this is really critical, providing accountability and encouragement. And I know that with many of you, and certainly with my clients, a big part of what I do is that. It's accountability and encouragement. We're always kind of coming back into the situation, revisiting topics from the past. Have you done this? Do you want to revisit that? How did we do? Sean, I'm concerned about the markets right now. Do we need to be doing anything different? It's a very useful relationship to have. And of course, review and fine tune. So this will be in the video, but all it does is that it tells you there's huge difference. Ipsos Reid did a study between advised and non-advised households, and they found in general at every income level, advised households had much more financial success than non-advised. And I go back to the very first few charts. That's likely the reason for the difference. So when the mass of investors are going one way, and you've got a coaching relationship, whoever it is, and in the midst of that volatility and concern and anxiety and the amygdala are just firing off, your advisor gives you some hopefully sage advice, they're a little bit more objective, right, and they hold you accountable for the principles that you have come to understand drive success in your portfolio. That's what it's all about, right? There's another study. For periods of time working with an advisor, there's been huge differences in terms of financial outcomes, in terms of portfolio value, you know, in general, right, for investors. Right. So it's, again, it sounds very self-serving, but I think it's useful to see that there's some data confirming some of that. I don't think that that wouldn't be news. I mean, an accountability kind of coaching relationship in every area of life is bound to make some kind of positive impact, right? I don't know of anyone that on their own in many areas of their life can just do it, right? We kind of slide into, you know, comfort zones pretty quick, and if there's somebody, you know, speaking, giving advice in our corner, sometimes that really is helpful. And this is the last part of the presentation, and then we will end. And I'm going to bore you to tears with this one, I guess, but I'll just continue on, so bear with me. This is called the total return equation. And when you look at return, there's all kinds of things that drive returns. We talked about asset mix already, so getting the asset mix right. Market beta, that's just a fancy name for how do the markets do. Are you getting at least market return? So if the TSX was up 10%, did you get 10%? Right? You have something called market alpha. And when we look for portfolio managers or products, alpha is return above the broad market. So if the TSX, the Canadian market, did 10% and you get another 2%, so 12%, that 2% is alpha. Like it looks return. You know, while you're hiring an advisor or working with someone, hopefully you're getting some alpha. There can be currency gains or losses. So currency plays a role in portfolio returns, so you need to manage that. And tax. Taxation plays a role in total return. So we have to connect that to your wealth plan, and we have to connect that to coaching, and I think we've got a really good solid strategy for growing investment wealth over time. So diversification is key. I think you've hit that, you know, we've covered that one. You have to customize your portfolio to your risk tolerance and the return objectives from your plan. And discipline is absolutely critical. It's one of the most difficult parts of this whole process. It really is hard. And this is the last point on planning. Many of you have heard me talk about something I refer to as an investment policy statement. And all it is like a mini financial plan. And many studies have confirmed that those people who do go through the process of building a mini plan for their portfolio do have better financial outcomes. And it really ties into that issue of accountability, expectations. And so an investment policy statement will basically evaluate the current goals, review income and liquidity needs. This talks about the portfolio in the context of your big picture. Do you need income? Will you need to reach into the portfolio for expenses? Right? How much return do you need to drive your retirement goals? I mean, all those things factor into the plan. Your tolerance for risk. How much can you handle, right, in terms of market fluctuation? That has to be factored in. And then prepare a written statement, and then, of course, implementation, and then finally review. So no portfolio should be static. It should be reviewed from time to time to be updated, and that goes without saying. Okay, you guys are very attentive. This was a lot of information in a short period of time, but I really, really appreciated the chance to have a chance to go through these points with you. We talked about the sort of the six mistakes that investors make. Hopefully, in going through the material, you know, you could get a basic sense of some of the key items you need to keep in mind. I'd say one of the most important things is just self-awareness. I really do think that whole issue of cognitive bias is an important exercise to go through. And just take some time to reflect on internal motivations, concerns, your family, your work context, all those things that kind of conspire to influence how you look at your investments. This is a worthwhile exercise to go through. Keep in mind that discipline is absolutely critical, and you have to learn to check your emotions at the door as much as possible. The average person can't do that very well, and that's where the coaching relationship really plays an important role in terms of long-term investment success. So I hope you found that overview helpful. For those of you that are guests, but even clients, you're aware of what we call the gap analysis. And really it is, whether it's retirement planning, investment planning strategies, estate planning strategies, we have a process that we walk people through that help to give them clarity on some of those main financial planning topics that they might be a little bit anxious about, maybe have some questions on. And it's a very comfortable process. It normally includes a 2 to 3 meeting process in that analysis. And it gives you a chance to get to know us a little bit. We get a chance to know you a little bit and to provide you with some very practical ideas that might be of some help to you. So if you do want to take advantage of the gap analysis, both as a client or a guest, make sure you let us know in the feedback form. And Janelle will be sure to contact you around that. So once again, everyone, thanks so much for coming out today. I hope that it was worth your time and effort to join us, and you got a few ideas that were helpful.